Today, let's see here. Today I am setting up Clipper on. Let me switch over to this printer here. So this printer here, you probably can't hear me very well, but this printer is a donor printer, not a donor printer. There's someone locally here that has a Voron 2. He started building during the V2.1, and then when V2.2 came out, he went ahead and upgraded. So this is a 350. It is currently V2.2, but since V2.4 parts have come out, we're gonna go ahead, get Clipper on this, and then eventually update the gantry and to V2.4, as well as Afterburner, just to kind of get to the latest point. I'm not going to touch the Z drives because those are fine as is. We might end up getting, I might end up recommending some metal 80 tooth because those are a little bit better. But these are actually PIF parts here, not the green ones, but the main ABS parts, and they're actually really high quality. And I say that like I'm surprised, but they are high quality. I think Maglin had printed these parts, and they're fantastic. These 80 teeth have great resolution, so there's probably no reason to upgrade to metal 80 tooth. But at least for the meantime, we'll be fine. Let's see here. So he has a Raspberry Pi. I believe this is a Pi 4. Oh, no, a Pi 3 Model B Plus, so not a Pi 4, but that's fine. He currently has the 5-volt power supply, so that's good for the Pi. And then he has a 12-volt power supply for his printer. One of the things we'll eventually be doing is upgrading that from a 12-volt to a 24-volt power supply, just because, in general, steppers are a lot more happy at 24 volts than 12 volts. The torque, and especially the torque at elevated speeds, is significantly higher. And for the spec motors, which he is currently running, the OMC 2 amp, 1.8 degree motors, the 17 HS19-2004 S1, those are great at both the standard 12 volts and 24 volts. But a lot of the other motors that you look at, like some of the OMC 0.9 degree steppers or LDO 0.9 degree steppers, those torque values are a decent bit lower than these. And so at 24 volts, they're fine, at least the ones with still a decent amount of torque. But at 12 volts, they're essentially not going to work at all. So in order to just give him room for future upgrades, we're going to go ahead and swap those out. However, today I'm primarily going to be focusing on installing essentially Octoprint and Clipper on the Raspberry Pi, which I've done a video on in the past, but we'll just do that quickly again. The other thing that may be of interest is both these SKR 1.3s, instead of essentially making him flip the printer over anytime the controllers need updating firmware, we're going to go ahead and install Better Bootloader on both of these drivers, which essentially makes it so that you don't need to do anything to like flip it over, access them physically to flash the boards. You can just do that directly from the USB cables and the command line. So you can just SSH into the Raspberry Pi, do the make menu config to select your controller settings, and then do make flash and flash each board individually. So that'll be a big quality of life upgrade. The other reason I'm doing that is because I'm really curious. I've been doing resonance testing here for the last bit, and I do not have a functional Voron V2 right now. I have one just off to the right of the camera, where essentially, I'll have one eventually, but that one I'll be going directly to a V2.4, so I won't have a functional V2.2. And this setup here really offers me an interesting opportunity to test the resonant frequencies of a V2.2, you know, as launched printer with the Bowden tool head, and then get all those resonant frequency measurements, you know, copy the same belt tension, etc., use the exact same parts, except for the updated printer parts, of course, and then measure those resonant frequencies again with V2.4 with the direct drive afterburner. So that's a really interesting comparison that I wouldn't have been able to do otherwise. But thanks to this gentleman that is local to me, who essentially asked me to help him out with this printer. There's no one else local really except him, so it's great to have someone closer than an hour and a half or 2 hours. But we'll be able to get that really interesting data. And one of the reasons for that, I'm really interested in it, is just to see how the different belt path with V2.4 is versus the V2.2. So I've went ahead, I've removed the micro SD card from the Raspberry Pi. So let's go over to the computer and download Octoprint and flash that now. So here we are. Let's go to Octoprint and look at that. That's one of my instances, so we won't go there. Let me switch my keyboard layout here. So octoprint.org. We are going to just download. In the future, I may do a mainsail setup, but right now, mainsail is still kind of being worked out, a little tweaks. They're right on the verge of merging essentially all of the API into the mainline Clipper. So one of the big limitations for me so far is previously with mainsail, you needed to be on ArcSign's fork in order to get mainsail running, because he had all the API stuff that hadn't gotten merged into Clipper yet. But I need to be on a different fork or different branch now of Clipper in order to run the accelerometer testing. So I've been using Octoprint still, but I will update soon. So let's go ahead and download just this latest version. This should take a minute, not very long. And then let's see here if I can type. Here we go. So again, here is the, let's see here. Metal 80 teeth is amazing. Yes. Can you hear me now? Let's see here. Make sure you can hear me now. I just saw your audio went low. I do have a different mic for when I'm next to the printer, and then when I'm at my computer. So when I'm walking back and forth until I switch the scene, it will be on the other one. So let's see here. Of course, right when I stream, download speed drops dramatically. Let me actually open up this and take this over to the other window. I may actually have an old Octopi. I do. Look at that. We're in luck. So I actually have a likely this exact same file that I've already downloaded. So we're going to extract that instead of waiting for this to download, because I thought with gigabit internet I'd be set, but apparently that's not the case here. So let's see here. It is still extracting. And let's see here. So I have this boot drive here. Here is the, this is what he had previously. And he has installed Clipper and Octoprint, which is great, but I don't have his password and the Wi-Fi set up differently and stuff like that. So I just figured it would be easier just to go ahead and start from scratch. Then I always know that I have the latest stuff now. So let's see here. So we have the image here. Let's see if there's anything else. Not right now. So we have the image. We'll use Etcher, flash from file, and go to downloads, Octopi Buster. And then we'll select this 32 gigabyte thing here. And we'll see how this goes. I have noticed that sometimes the
at the end with my my specific micro SD card reader, the essentially it'll try to verify it and it will be ejecting at the same time, and then it will fail the verification. However, it still works properly. Let's see here. And of course, I may have plugged this into a USB 2.0 port, but that'll be fine for now. Let's see here. Yeah, so I'm really excited for this resonance data. The one thing that I am curious about, and this is somewhat counterintuitive, you'd think a less restrictive belt path is better, and from a resistance standpoint, how fast, or essentially the torque you need to move your tool head around, I believe that's the case, it makes sense. But from a damping standpoint, and essentially how long your resonant vibrations last, it may actually be a good thing, and good is a relative term. You know, we'd prefer to have no resonance at all, but, you know, with input shaper and a less restrictive belt path that essentially allows the tool head to vibrate freely, we should be able to get the best of both worlds. So, yeah, here's that error I was talking about. It did successfully complete, but it didn't verify it. So, let's see here. So, if we go back to the PC... I think in this case, I actually have to remove the SD card and then insert it back. Hopefully. Maybe not. Let's see here. Let's try this. There we go. Okay, so here's the boot. We're going to need to edit this right here. So I'm going to edit with Notepad++. And essentially this section right here is what you need to change. So remove the comments. And then I'm going to move this window over to the side so I can put in my SSID and password. Let's see here. One moment. See if this works. You'd think that this would be easy, but on my Windows desktop, I have a when I was in high school, I taught myself to type in Dvorak. This is probably not how you say it, but I know two keyboard layout, but I only know one language. So on this Windows computer, since Fusion has all of its shortcuts kind of mapped out, you know, for QWERTY essentially, I have it auto default to that. But then I still want to type a lot of the times in Dvorak, which is annoying when Windows keeps switching back and forth without asking me. So, let's see here. This is funny. I'll get it eventually. There we go. Okay, so I've saved the WPA supplicant with the SSID and password for my network, and that's really all we need to do here. You'll notice that there's this SSH file here, and essentially what that does with Octoprint, you don't need to worry about it. because the image already has this. But if you're installing from a default Raspbian image, SSH is not enabled by default, so you need to add this essentially empty file with the title SSH, and that will enable SSH, so you don't need to hook a keyboard and mouse up to the Raspberry Pi to get it set up. So we will go ahead and eject that. And let's switch over to the printer for a second.
So we're back at the printer. I'm going to insert this SD card into the Raspberry Pi. Let's see if I can do that. Yep, there we go. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and turn this on. Let's see here. That's good. We get power. We get the activity light from the Raspberry Pi. So that's booting up now. It'll probably take a minute for that to connect. But yeah, so let's jump back over to the computer.
Okay. So, let me... I have a few instances of Octoprint on my network. So I'm going to use the IP address to connect. So we'll see if I can see it on the network. And yes, I can. So it does not have an IP address yet. But now it does. Okay, so we're going to go to 192.168.1.57. Yeah, the missing plugins for Octoprint or for Mainsail is kind of scary. I can't say there's many I regularly used. The one I'd probably be most concerned about losing would be the cancel region, because you know that is really convenient to have in case you're doing a huge print and full build plate, and then one of your components messes up. I don't print full build plates all that often. I don't do PIF or anything like that, and it's usually just small batches of development parts. So here is the intro to Octoprint here. I'm actually going to go ahead and ignore that for now. And we will go SSH pi et 192.168. There we go. And yes. And then the default password is Raspberry. And we're in. So we're in this is great. Let's do sudo, again, if I figure out what keyboard layout Windows thinks I'm in, sudo raspi config and res. There's Raspberry. Okay, so here's, right now I'm gonna leave the default password as Raspberry. So I'm not gonna change that. I would recommend changing that for you, but since this printer is for someone else, they can essentially go in and change it once they get it. There's not a lot you need to change here. The one thing I will be changing is SPI. I'm going to enable this because I know I'm going to need it later for the accelerometer. And let's finish. And then let's go over to Clipper. Again, if I can figure out what keyboard layout's going on. So, and here, this is the instruction set for Clipper. Again, I'm just going to copy these commands to essentially clone the Clipper repo into the Raspberry Pi, and then we'll do the install script here. Yeah, I've heard people discussing the exclude region. and it would be great to be able to do that. But yeah, I agree. It's going to be difficult. The other plugin that I do like that I use a lot is, or it's a peace of mind thing, is there's a TP-Link smart plug, the HS110, that has kind of built-in watt meter. And I actually do like that a lot because I can see how much power consumption the printer's using at the moment. Someone made a nice plugin for Octoprint where you can monitor that real time and log history over time. And it doesn't use the cloud. It's actually direct connected to the IP address of the plug. The other nice thing about that is they do have some safety features in there where if for some reason, you know, Clipper's going to shut down if your say hot end temperature gets to like 400 degrees or above a certain threshold. However, in the case of say a MOSFET, essentially locking on, there's not really much it can do other than try to turn it off, and throw a warning. The nice thing about that smart plug is that in Octoprint, you can set a threshold for maximum temperature, or some other things like that. Essentially, if Clipper throws an error, that plugin would send a command to the smart plug to essentially cut off power to the entire printer. Again, there's a lot of questions about, like, okay, if you're relying on Wi-Fi, like a Wi-Fi connected device, as a safety guard, that's probably not the best thing. You want it to be a you know, secondary or, you know, nth layer line of defense. But for me, it's a nice extra, you know, safety precaution. I do also have a smoke alarm over my printer, and it's also good to have a fire extinguisher handy. You never know when you're building this what could go wrong. Even if you follow all the guides and sometimes you just don't quite know what things to look for, or maybe you had a bad crimp somewhere or something you didn't quite see, you know, a wire got pinched or something got shorted, and you might not see that for a while. You know, again, all of these are self-built printers, and it's really key to, you know, to be cautious. But we haven't had any fires yet for Voron printers, but again, as the community grows larger, it's your printer is only as good as your common sense and your knowledge on, you know, how carefully you assembled it. So I think the closest one was someone I know. I think something happened with the probe where it shorted out, and it ended up, you know, that wire essentially ended up overheating and melting some other wires close by, and it made a lot of smoke. Luckily, nothing caught fire. But it's still just a reminder to be cautious. We're working with, you know, elevated or, you know, standard line voltage, and really anything can potentially be a safety risk unless you're taking proper precautions. But that was a really long side tangent. Okay, so we've cloned in Clipper. Let's run the install script. And this is going to run for a minute. And then before we get here, so here's where we're kind of going to go off the beaten path a little bit. If you got lucky when you bought an SKR 1.3, if you bought them very early on, Big Tree Tech used to send Smoothieware as the default bootloader, which was great because that worked with Clipper out of the box. Clipper could flash over USB. However, over time, essentially, I guess they found out or realized that Marlin is by far the biggest, you know, printer firmware. And so in order to make it easier for the 90% or 95% or I don't know what percentage of printers are Marlin, but they ship with the Marlin bootloader now, which you can't flash over USB from Clipper. So let me pull up a link here. And I am just searching, let's see here, bootloader and Clipper. I can put a link in the description of this later on, but I literally just searched bootloader in Discord, in the Voron Discord, and in the first page there was essentially a link to this this repo here. So some people from Voron packaged this together for Clipper, If we go to tags, this 0.4.1 is the latest bootloader for the SKR 1.3 and 1.4. So we're going to, you know, it's a fairly simple process. Before you do this, I want to make sure to emphasize, you can brick your SKR doing this. To my knowledge, I've never heard of anyone bricking an SKR 1.3 or 1.4. However, for instance, if you went ahead and if you essentially, you know, put in the SD card, powered on the SKR, and then like immediately took off power, so it was essentially in the middle of flashing the bootloader, you could essentially get a SKR that is unusable. And in that case, you can recover that. You can essentially flash it using, I don't remember exactly, it's essentially a flash programmer for these chips. But it's not super trivial, which is why we haven't really advertised this option as, you know, every single one person should do this. Because a lot of people are not really going to update Clipper that often. And if you're not updating Clipper, you don't need to update the code on the microcontroller. However, if you are updating Clipper and you're willing to take the risk, or you're willing to either buy another board if you bricked the one you have, or if you are handy enough to essentially recover the board using using another device, then that's fine as well. So let's see here. So betterbootloader.bin, we're going to save that file. And then that's still working. So I'm going to go ahead, we've done that. I'm going to go ahead and jump over to the other camera, to the printer, and we're going to pull the two SD micro SD cards on the SKR boards out and put essentially the Better Bootloader bin file on them. So let me jump over there.
Okay, so we're back over here, and I was not thinking very clearly, because obviously these are currently powered, and I'm going to wait a minute until Clipper's finished flashing on the Pi. I could probably loosen up some things here, but honestly, I don't want to risk it, so I'm going to leave those alone for now. Let's jump back over to the computer.
Okay, so let's see here, 4 minutes. Let's see, no questions, which is fine. So I'll go ahead and talk a little bit about what I've been working on recently with the accelerometer. So here, let's see, let me switch over to my other camera so you can actually see this. So yeah, so this board here, this is the accelerometer I'm talking about. This one, I actually bought the cheap version off of Amazon. Adafruit also has a version that has some additional features on it. It's a little more expensive. I think it's maybe $18 or $20. I was cheap, so I bought the $5 or $6 version. And it actually seems to work a little better with the Raspberry Pi. I'm not exactly sure why, but I've noticed some people have issues with it. Maybe because of the level shifting and the Raspberry Pi and maybe the data transfer rates. I'm not exactly sure. So the cool thing with that is, you know, again, we can get data from the tool head. That's great. I'm trying to back out the resonant frequency, kind of calculating the resonant frequency from Gates, essentially the Young's modulus of Gates belts, essentially their stiffness, and trying to calculate the resonant frequency across the entire build area. There's a lot of cool things there, but again, it looks like this is locked up. And this is my my fault, because I literally have a switch right here. I could have wired Ethernet over there, but I did not. Let's see here. Hmm. Let me do this. See if it's actually responding at all. Oh, we can go through Octoprint setup. Here we go. Okay, so we can do this in parallel. Access control, I mentioned this in my previous video. You know, it's great to say, you know, give it a username and password. Again, since I'm not the end user of this printer, I'm not going to enable this. And I'm going to say yes, proceed. Ensure enable anonymous usage tracking. And this is these defaults are fine. You can go ahead with them. And one of the bad things about Octoprint is the plugins. Sometimes it's the good and bad thing. The plugins can sometimes figure out how to say this. So if you're running your print essentially on Marlin, and Octoprint is just sending files to your printer or something like that, it's not a big deal if Octoprint takes a lot of resources. But with Clipper, since you're doing all the motion planning on the Pi itself, if like Print Time Genius, I've seen before where it, and with some settings, it can take a ton of CPU resources. And in those cases, you can get stuttering on your prints. And it looks really strange because the toolhead stops for a minute when it's not supposed to. And then essentially all of the pressure buildup in the hot end itself, especially if you have a Bowden setup, essentially oozes out and you get all these little zits, which is really annoying. So it's generally good to enable this. I'm assuming that blocks those you know, plugins from harming your prints. Let's see here. I thought I had enabled. I got that same bug last time I did this too. But so I'm going to name this Voron. And then in this case, so we're rectangular. The origin is in the lower left. No heated chamber, heated bed. And this is a 350 by 350. And even though this is a V2.2, which has a 350Z, this will be a V2.4. So I'm going to go ahead and set this to 330. Due to the slightly taller tool head and some other things like that, you essentially had to package the extruder above the tool head. We lost a little Z. So a 350 millimeter Z printer before becomes a 330. A lot of times that's not an issue though, because most people don't use the full Z height. But at least we're honest now. So if you need the full 350, then you can build, you can get slightly taller extrusions and rails. Let's see here. Check on this again. That is locked up. I feel like I've done this in the past and it was a bad idea, so I'm going to hit ignore. Okay. That's fun. Oh, okay, it's dropping off. Not sure if it's just not downloading or if it's not... it's locked up entirely. If you have any suggestions, let me know. The nuclear option is just to essentially reflash Octoprint and start over. I am not by any means a software firmware person. I can copy code, or I can copy scripts and go from there, but other than that, I'm kind of stuck. So, oh, maybe it did finish, it just didn't scroll down. Okay, so we're good. Okay, so we have launched Clipper, which is great. Look at that. I'm going to put this to the side, and I'm going to go ahead. So we can go ahead and do a sudo a shutdown, and this will shut down the Pi, so then we can grab those micro SD cards and flash that. So let's jump over. If I can figure out where OBS is.
There we go. Okay, so this is shut down. You can see the red LED is illuminated. The green LED is not. So if you've been watching it for a minute and the green LED hasn't come on at all, it's generally safe. The Pi is already shut down. You don't want to turn off the Pi while it is still running, because then you can corrupt the memory card. But we're going to go ahead and turn that off. And wait for all the LEDs to turn off, which means the capacitors have discharged there. And then we can go ahead and grab these micro SD cards. So there's one. And there's another. So there's two 128 megabyte cards. Let's go ahead and get those flashed.
So the key thing to note about these cards is you don't actually need them to run the printer. So once you flash a better bootloader or flash any other Clipper firmware, it doesn't actually need the SD card. So in case you only have one micro SD card or something like that, you can repurpose it for both your SKRs or something like that, just temporarily. But my puppy is currently whining at me. Hopefully that doesn't mean what I think it means. Okay, so we have downloaded a better bootloader right here. We'll drag that to there. And so better bootloader bin, we need to rename it to firmware.bin. And then we'll go ahead and copy that onto this. And that's it. We'll go ahead and eject that. And then we'll stick the other card in. If I'm putting it upside down, yep. Okay, so I have the other card in, and we'll do the exact same thing. Assuming my file explorer loads. There we go. We'll copy the same bootloader onto there. Then we'll eject that one as well. Then we'll jump back over to the printer.
So we have the micro SD cards here. I'm going to go ahead and insert them back into the SKR. And then here's the second one. So there's both of those. I'm going to jump back over to the computer just to double check the instructions one more time, just to make sure I don't mess anything up.
Okay, so we're going to look at this again. Insert the SD card into the SKR 1.3, power it on, wait 10 seconds, then reset. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and... trying to decide if I should take a break from my puppy or not, but I'm gonna go ahead and power on the printer.
So we'll turn that on, and I'm gonna go ahead and wait for a full minute on this. Again, it is always better when you're flashing the bootloader like this to wait longer than a shorter amount of time, because if you do it too short, essentially your boards are bricked and you have to fix them. So let's see here. So that's been on for a while. I did not count, but It's been a while. So let's see here. There is a reset button on these SKRs. So we'll press that, and then we'll press this as well. And then hopefully we will be able to see those pop up flashed.
Okay, so we have flashed those. Let's jump back into the Raspberry Pi. Assuming I type Raspberry correct. And then let's go ahead and let's see here. Do the CD Clipper. I can just copy it. My track record for typing accurately is not very high right now. And then the make menu config. So this will open up the configuration to make the firmware files for your SKR. So in this case, let's see here. The LPC-1768 is the SKR 1.3 and 1.4. And the 1769 is the 1.4 turbo. Again, for our purposes, the 1.3 or 1.4 are fine, but we'll select that. Again, for the 1.3 and 1.4, you select the 100 megahertz. If you are using the 1.4 turbo because you got it for on sale or something like that, you would select the 120 megahertz here. And then, let's see here. The one interesting thing, typically you don't need to worry about it, but if you haven't used Clipper for a while, what is interesting here is you can use the serial number from the chip ID. So in the past, if you had two boards, you could essentially name them two different things, and then every time you reflashed, you'd have to name those custom again. So then... if you didn't want to do that, you could use by path. But then if you use by path and then you plug in your SKR boards into different USB ports, then that messed it up as well. Now it essentially names the device by the serial number of the board of the micro itself. So you never have to worry about that again. I believe the configs on the Voron GitHub may still use by path. Hopefully I've updated it to by ID, but we'll do that in the future. If not yet. So exit, yes, we want to save that. And then let's do make, make. So here it's making the firmware files. And then we'll run this, assuming I copied it, run this command. So it sees one of them. And this is likely because the, so essentially that better bootloader essentially named both devices the same. So that's fine. It just means that when we flash them, we may need to essentially disconnect one and then flash the other. After you flash it the first time, after a better bootloader, you won't have to do this again. But let's see here. So I'm going to disconnect one of the SKRs quick. So now only one is connected via USB. So I'll just do that one more time. See, one still pops up. So we can flash these. Let's see here. So, and then this make flash here, what we want to do is essentially by ID. Then, nope. Let's see if I can copy that and paste it. Nope. Look, this is great. USB per. See if that works. And voila, that's done. So that is essentially all you need to do then. So this is why it is so much nicer to use Better Bootloader, because instead of doing that micro SD card shuffle that I did, taking it out of the SKR, plugging it into your computer, putting the firmware file on there, and you would actually have to do one more additional step, which is get the generated firmware file off the Raspberry Pi. Here you can just do it all in one step. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to go ahead and disconnect the SKR board that is currently plugged in, and I'm going to plug in the other one, assuming that my puppy doesn't get tangled in the microphone. Okay, so then we'll go ahead, check this again. It's the same ID because it's the same bootloader before. So we will just do make flash. And that's done. Okay, so if we do ID again, you see now this name that used to be this essentially has the full serial number of the LPC-1768. So now I'll go ahead and plug the other SKR back in. And just like that, we have two. So both of those are flashed with the latest version of the Clipper microcontroller firmware, essentially. So the only thing after that is to do sudo service Clipper start. And that's it. Okay, so let's see here. I'm trying to think. What time is it? 8:41. So we can go ahead and I'm going to take a break because I think my puppy is wanting to go outside. So I'm going to step away for a minute, but I'll be back in maybe 5 minutes. And we are back. Let's see here. So, see what we want to do next. Let's go ahead and get Octoprint set up to interface with Clipper here. I think this is one section that, let's see here. I think this is one section I did not cover in my previous video. So this will be good for those of you who were asking about that. So settings, I haven't done this in a long time, so bear with me. Serial connection, add additional serial ports, add temp printer, and then hit save. Settings, serial connection, change the serial port to temp printer, save. Settings tab, navigate to behavior subtab, and select the cancel any ongoing prints but stay connected to the printer. And I think I've noticed a few times that someone was complaining about Clipper. I think they had just set it up the first time. They were complaining that anytime there was an error, essentially the computer, the printer essentially shut down, the fans turned to 100% whenever Clipper has an error. And they were complaining about that. This setting is the setting that causes that. If you do not switch from disconnect to printer to cancel the print but keep, you know, connection to the printer, essentially Octoprint will disconnect and it'll be annoying. So we'll hit save. Main page under connection. Serial port is temp printer and click connect. And then here's the ultimate test, which is if we do status, this makes sense. So we do not have a config file yet, which makes sense because we haven't actually loaded that in. So let's see here. Let's go to Voron Design, or the Voron GitHub. This is a Voron 2, and we have, so there's, for a while I've had my SKR documentation in the Voron users repo, and there is a Voron 2 configuration there that I have not removed yet. But all of the official firmware configurations now are present in the actual Voron 1 or Voron 2 repos. And that's important because, one, it's easier to get merged in there because there's not 30 other pull requests that the GitHub admins have to go through. But the one on the Voron users repo essentially is still configured for a V2.2 with the Mobius. So it's going to have the wrong step distance. It's going to have the current for your TMC driver set way too high. It's defaulted to 1.0 amps instead of like 0.5, which you probably won't completely destroy your pancake stepper on your extruder if you have an afterburner and use that firmware config, but it will definitely not be happy. I've seen, I think it was when we were doing a Jetpack beta, there was a few people that forgot to change the current down from the default to like half an amp, and essentially it the stepper motor got so hot that it started melting the ABS. So that's generally a good thing to not do. So the latest firmware is here, and this is an SKR 1.3, and again this is a temporary placeholder. This config and the wiring is still the most accurate. If you want to go through the SKR documentation, it is still on the Voron users repo. We are working on updating it to be essentially, you know, it doesn't care what controller you use. You'll have wiring diagrams, whether you're a 1.3, 1.4, maybe even if you're using a 1.3 for X, Y, an extruder, and then a 1.4 for the Z, like you may be able to mix and match like that, which would be really cool. Hopefully that makes it a lot more scalable down the road. But let us do this. So actually I probably already have it downloaded. Let's see here. So if we go to firmware, Clipper configurations, SQR 1.3. So I'm just going to copy that to the desktop for a minute here. And then, let's see, am I using PuTTY? No, that's not it. Here we go, 1SCP. So we need to essentially get that firmware. Let me just a second here. We need to get that firmware file to the Raspberry Pi. You can pull out the SD card and put it on manually, or you can do this as well. Let's see, new session. That's not the one I want. So you want SFTP, not FTP. And in this case, 192.168.1.57. And then we're using the default Pi and Raspberry for this with this setup. Cross our fingers. This should, yes, we do know what this is. Perfect. So now we're connected. So we're in the home Pi folder. This is actually where the printer config should be. So all we really need to do is I'm going to copy it and paste it here. And then I'm going to rename this to printer.config. Then we'll go ahead and drop this over there. And if we do it's still not going to like it because we did not put the we did not change the microcontroller IDs essentially. But this time it should say yes. So it's throwing a bunch of errors, which makes sense. So we'll have to actually go through the config. Essentially, I've made this default configuration so that you have to go through and choose different parameters. Because I want you to really be aware. I don't want you to essentially do what I just did and run with it. Because if it worked off the bat, and you had the wrong size printer, you had a different stepper driver type or stepper motor or something like that, you'd never really have gone to the configuration. You could end up doing something that would be bad. So what we want to do really is double check all those settings. So we're going to have to actually go through and edit some things. So let's see here. I'm just going to go ahead. I'm not going to do that. We will open up that in Notepad++. Cancel. Don't worry about that right now. Edit with Notepad++. We'll bring this over here. So the first thing is really this. Again, as I mentioned before, we want to use by ID now. And I need to update this. But if we go back up, here are our two IDs. What we need to figure out is which one is the X and which is the, or the X, Y, and extruder, and which is the Z. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to disconnect the SKR 1.3 board from the Pi that has the Z steppers connected to it. And that will basically just remain or leave the X, Y, and E one. So let's jump over to the printer.
So the other thing I'm understanding and expecting that these wires aren't going to be exactly perfect because he has wired this up for probably a past configuration or something like that. But if we look closely. This one has three wires going into it, so X, Y, and E. And then this one has four for all of your four Z steppers. So this is your X, Y, E. So we want to leave that one connected. We'll disconnect this one. So this is the Z. And then we'll go back and update the printer config.
Okay, so if we send the by ID, that was the wrong one. Okay, so if we do this, now this gives us the, this is the ID for the, there's got to be a way of copying this, and I know you guys are probably laughing, but I typically use my laptop that is a MacBook to do this, and honestly, right now, I don't want to copy that, because that would be just terrible. So we can use the bypass too. let me just show you what that looks like. That's basically what it looks like. So in this case, we actually probably got lucky because they already matched, which was probably what was really strange, because typically your by path, these default IDs would not match with your printer has. But for some reason, we got lucky, and that's why it went. If you noticed a little bit ago, it aired out on quad gantry level, not on, it can't connect to MCU Z or XYE. So we're actually, I think we're good there for the purposes of this video. If I was right click, let's see here. Oh, look at that. It did copy. Thank you, chat. I appreciate it. Let's see if this works. Paste. Well, look at that. Well, then, we'll just do that. Learn something new every day, right? Okay, so that is the ID for the X. And then we'll go ahead and we'll plug in the Z MCU. Let me just do that quick. Okay, let's run that command one more time. And then it is this A. So, copy. You're probably gonna, does that work? Ah, I forgot this. Okay, so there's that. Just double checking to make sure those are correct. And they are. Okay, so that's updated. So the first section here then is the printer section. These values are fine. I'd probably delete this line now that now with what I know. But again, if your printer is on 12 volts, consider upgrading to 24 volts because it will help you a lot. We have seen, so theoretically, a V2 can do really, really high Z speeds. But for 12 volts, we've noticed on the TMC drivers, sometimes it does skip steps if you go too fast. And that is because the torque drops off a lot quicker with 12 volts versus 24 volts. Actually, let me see if I probably don't have that open. No, nothing there. Oh, well, we'll look at that another time. I'm going to assume, so all these settings should be correct. If I need to change something, it would be on the printer to fix the wiring. It would not be here, but we do have a 350 printer. Again, we're going to home nice and slow to make sure nothing's damaged. And then we are using 2209, drivers here. So we'll update this, and you'll notice if you, looked at the previous configs on Voron users, I did use higher current, which is not really needed. I was originally thinking higher current is better, and it is, but up to a certain point, it's just overkill, and you don't really need that. If you go too high and your cooling isn't good enough, you'd actually get issues from the TMC stepper drivers overheating. That applies more to the 2208s and maybe the 2130s. More than the 2209s because they generate more heat, but you know, you don't need to go that high. So 0.8 amps is fine. Let's see here. Again, we have a 350 build. Let's one comment that. And again, 2209. And you may question why I force you to put 2209 in each section. And that is actually because if you're using 2208s, which I realize aren't that common anymore, 2208s actually almost run perfectly with this configuration if you specify 2209. Except there's some really funky behavior that is just normal enough, but not normal enough that you're wondering if it's a mechanical issue, but it is not. And I forget who it was I was going with through their printer, and I could not figure out why it was doing that. But then that's why I changed it, so you have to enter that yourself. So Z-steppers, again, just as a configuration tip, if you've never done Clipper before, essentially all these pin numbers go to different pins on the micro that it's controlling. And if you have defined your controller as just essentially with no extra name, like this has a Z, this doesn't have anything, then you can just write the pin name down without any extra kind of additional information on it. But if you define a MCUZ, or say you add another controller, maybe a Clipper expander, or maybe you're crazy and you have like 10 billion other steppers controlling something else, you can keep adding MCUs. You just need to add this value essentially in front of the pin number, so that it knows that it's sending that data to this microcontroller and not the default one. So once we get to, you know, so the X and Y are all the standard pin values because they're using essentially the default microcontroller. But once we get down to Z, you'll notice all of these have Z and colon in front of them to specify it is the Z micro. And also the direction pins, you'll see that a few times as the exclamation mark essentially inverts the pin. So it's opposite. And we may use that here in the future. I'm not sure if we'll move the stepper motors tonight because I still need to print off a few more parts. But if your steppers are going the wrong direction, you can essentially add or remove the exclamation mark to get that to work. So here again, I'm going to set this to 330. And go through here again. The other thing you will notice if you've used my previous Voron users config is that I used to define interpolate false. And that again was really maybe an extreme measure to make sure that if people were running this configuration, it was 100% going to work. It may be really noisy, but it would work. Because if you're trying to hunt down maybe belt tension or a loose grub screw or something like that, you want to be able to make sure that your config is not the problem. In this case, I think we have enough data now from people building printers that interpolate true really doesn't impact stuff too much, especially if you're running 24 volts. It may be good to default to false with 12 volts, but I found that people complained about noise so much. Like, you want the start of your first printer, let's start, you know, you've been working toward this goal for months, waiting on parts and building. And then if your printer moves and it's like sound, it shakes the whole table and it sounds terrible, then you're like, why did I buy this? And I didn't want that to be the first reaction. Because in reality, you know, after you confirm that everything moves, you'd immediately go in and change this to true. For Stealth Chop, I would not recommend using Stealth Chop unless you absolutely have to. I would suggest going to 0.9 degree steppers before going to Stealth Chop. And that is coming from someone who has tried to use Stealth Chop on every single printer, you know, constantly trying to tweak settings to get it to work until I got the OMC 0.9 degree steppers. And I understand there's a ton of them, but if you want the model number, I can let you know. But once I got those, for some reason, my printer is just so much quieter. It doesn't resonate as much. And I upgraded right when it was at the start of the pandemic, and my office was essentially 3 feet away from my printer. So I couldn't have it, you know, making a lot of noise during a conference call or something like that. But now essentially it is so quiet, I don't have to worry about that. So great upgrade. If you're building a printer from the ground up, you might as well just go ahead and buy those. They're maybe a few dollars more expensive, and you really only need those for the A and B motors. But we'll add in these. Okay. Extruder, and here's essentially a general guide on configuring the step distance. Again, if you're coming from Marlin, Marlin uses steps per millimeter, and this is step distance, which is the inverse of that, so millimeters per step. And this step distance is not full step distance, but micro step distance. So If you ever change your microstep settings in your configuration, you will need to change your step distance as well, because you know it'll probably be half or double or something like that of this original value. But this value is great, great starting point for Afterburner, but you always want to tweak this to make sure your extrusion is correct. Because if your extruder is calibrated, then you know you can use similar values to other people on the internet that have also calibrated their extruders. But if you don't, then you could say, oh, I run my extrusion at 105%, and someone else could say 90%, and they could mean the exact same thing in reality. But since one or neither of their extruders are calibrated, then it's just useless, essentially. This the other thing to note is this sensor type here is, I think, a fairly safe guess now. For certain thermistors from China, you could potentially get a different sensor, but I would just encourage you to look at the listing of the, you know, if it's Triangle Lab, they'll have a few different thermistor listings available, and you can essentially compare what your thermistor wires look like and see what it is, but it's probably going to be this. If you're printing ABS at like 260 degrees or something like that, and you're wondering why, you're maybe not actually printing at 260 degrees. So go ahead and double check your thermistor setting. Because if you almost never want to print ABS that high, because you can get it so high that it kind of cooks and it's more brittle than strong. So the other thing to note here, this minimum temperature, it's a really easy thing. So there's a safety check in Clipper. So in this case, right now, if there was not a thermistor plugged into this channel, this sensor pin, then essentially it would throw an error saying ADC, the analog to digital conversion range, is out. So there's something's wrong. It is easy to set this to like -1,000 and just go on your way and say, you know, essentially bypass that error during setup. But it's also really easy to keep going on with your printer build and never remember that you changed it to that. And then essentially if your thermistor breaks or something like that, you'll never have a firmware notification that something went wrong. So I would encourage you to keep this at default if at all possible. Just you don't want to disable safety features that are there, because it's just generally better to not do that. We don't want anyone to essentially get hurt. The other thing, max temperature. Make sure that your hot end is not the PTFE lined hot end. If you do have a PTFE lined hot end, don't go up to 270. If you want to go above 270, I would encourage you to look into spec sheets for thermistors and give yourself a good margin of safety on the high end. I think this thermistor officially is good to 300C, but you know, potentially if you're getting a thermistor from China or an unknown source, maybe the maybe it was out of spec, or maybe it was a lower quality, or you know, who knows what happened. But I would encourage you not to run this all the way up to the max spec. I think E3DD rates to 285. But if you're running up at those high temperatures, it generally means you're printing something that is not standard. Again, if you're printing ABS at 285, then something else is wrong. You shouldn't be doing that. But if you're printing higher than 270, get a PT100 or PT1000 or something else like that that essentially registers values up at that range. I'm going to stop for a second and talk about max power. I've noticed recently that it seems to be a trend that people want to stick the highest wattage heater cartridge in their hot end. I think I'm not exactly sure who released it, but someone did like a 70 watt, maybe, or 60 watt, maybe 100 watt, and Triangle Labs released a 60 watt, I believe. There's no need for a 60 watt hot end. Essentially the melt zone of your hot end is going to be the limiting factor. And essentially every amount of power that is, you know, even, okay, so say if you use a 100 watt hot end, one, the controller board is going to be strained because likely it was not designed to, the hot end MOSFET was not designed to switch that much. The second thing is, you know, even though if it runs great and it's switching on and off correctly, you know, during a normal print, maybe you're using 20% of that 100 watts, it still means in a runaway case that you have the full 100 watts. If the MOSFET essentially locks on and fails, then that full 100 watts is going to run away. And there's no, unlike the heated bed where we have the thermal cutout, there's no limitation on how hot that'll be. So, and there's not really anything to cool it off. So your hot end's going to get ridiculously hot, you know, to the point where you could melt a lot of things. And that's how fires start. So again, I encourage you to use the smallest wattage possible for any, essentially any purpose you have. So if you can get away with a 30 or 40 watt hot end, which 90%, you know, 99% can, go with that. Even with like a high flow dragon, you probably shouldn't need more than a 40 watt. So the other thing to note is that as we have an enclosed build volume, it takes even less power to maintain temperature. Where, you know, for instance, maybe in an ambient of 25 C, it, you know, you have a, you know, it just takes less power. To the point where my V1.8 takes, I think, like 120 watts while it's printing. It can get down to 100 watts, and that's at full ABS printing. So if you're buying a 100 watt heat hot end and a 1000 watt heated bed, it's just overkill, and it's just going to be extra ways for the printer to, you know, start a fire, essentially. So I'm going to get off that soapbox. Then the last thing here with pressure advance, you'll note I do default to 0.05. In the past, I've set that to zero. 0.05 is a little on the low end. It could probably go up to 0.08, but at least out of the box, you have a pretty good starting point there. So that was a long bit of information there, but run current half an amp RMS. So that times 1.4, essentially the square root of 2, you have a little headroom there, not a lot. You can run this at 0.6 if you need to. I would encourage you, if you are having issues with like essentially extrusion, maybe the motor stopping, I would check how free the filament path is, how easy it is to push the filament through, and then also make sure that there's no weird like bit of plastic hanging out that's you know, stopping it from rotating freely, because unless your stepper motor is faulty, then you probably shouldn't need to drive it higher than this. But so let's see here, heater bed, max power. This comes back to the same calculations we were doing before. Essentially, the Kinova heaters that we buy are typically 600 to 750 watts. And you want to limit that max power. Again, this is not a hardware limit. This is a software limit. But it slows the heat up time so that your bed doesn't warp. It does not, however, protect you in the case of an SSR failure. So if your SSR fails on, maybe you got a cheap Chinese one, maybe it wasn't rated for high enough current, something like that. If that fails, the cheap ones generally fail closed, then this max power goes out the window and your heated bed is going to run away at the full 750 or 600 or 800 watts. And that will quickly become, you know, get to the point where it's going to start essentially falling off the build plate. And that's really where the thermal fuse comes into play. It's really critical that you install that. I know it's a pain. It's an extra step. It's an extra hole to drill to try to figure out how to mount it, but it is important. So let's see. probe. Okay, this is interesting stuff as well. So how much do I want to get into this? I don't want to get into this too much, but again, we're not using the probe for absolute values. We're just using it for relative. But this Y offset is correct for a V2 and a V1, but essentially it tells the printer how far away the probe is from the nozzle. And this comes into effect if you're using bed mesh, because the new implementation of that essentially moves the tool head so the probe is at the point you're measuring, not the nozzle. The important part here is that if you're choosing mesh points, you can't, if your offset is 25 millimeters, you can't say I want to probe at say 10 millimeters from the edge, because the tool head can't actually reach that value. If you have any more questions about that, let me know. But the other thing with the probe is the number of samples. This is really kind of important, because any of the probes we're using are going to have some drift with temperature. So as the printer heats up, as the enclosure heats up, as the probe heats up, it will slowly drift in sense distance over time. So you want to make sure that your printer is heated up and stabilized before you go do any real crazy kind of adjustment. Because, for instance, if you did a 100 by 100 bed mesh, which would be stupid, but if you did that and your probe was still heating up, you know, you'd essentially have a warped bed mesh, because your probe sense distance would be adjusting over the entire course of the bed mesh calibrate. The other thing that you'll notice sometimes is that if you're probing the bed and you're, say you have 3 samples or 5 samples or something like that, sometimes it'll seem like the first sample is always off, and then the next samples are kind of all tightly together. And that, I forget who it was that came up with the theory, but essentially it has something to do with depending on if your probe is normally open or normally closed. Essentially, that there's, you know, some filtering circuitry on the the controller board. Maybe there's some slight capacitance there, and so your first trigger seems to always lag a little bit to detect, and then the next one, since you're doing them really quickly, they all kind of have the same charge time and discharge time, so they all end up being the same reading. So I'd encourage you to either do like 1 sample, which is what I do now, or do like 3 or 5 samples to try to kind of throw out that first sample and get the next ones down. But if you have done a probe accuracy on your probe and you're sure of your warm-up routine, there's no real reason to do 3. 1 is more than enough, and it helps speed up your print start time as well and stuff like that, since you don't have to probe as much. But okay, so hot end fan, nothing real there. This part cooling fan is actually interesting. So let's see here. I have deleted a line. Let's see if it's anywhere else. I've deleted the line called cycle time, because I realized that I had set it to, for some reason in the config, it was set to 0.001 seconds, which if you read the actual documentation, the minimum value is 0.010 seconds. What that does is essentially means that your print cooling fan may not start up at low speeds. So I've removed that line, so it defaults to the 10 milliseconds. And that seems to work well for a lot of fans. But if your fan has issues, you can add that line back in and slowly increase the cycle time so that it can work. The other thing, though, is this off below command. And this says that if you try to run your fan below 10%, then it will not run. You're essentially saying that I've checked my fan and I know that I can start at 10% and it will continue to run at 10%. And you want to make sure this is correct, because if, for instance, this is off below 5%, but your fan cannot run at 5%, then your print or your slicer settings may may move your fan all the way down to 5%, which stalls the fan out. And then essentially it will start increasing the fan speed again. But maybe there's a range, maybe it doesn't start up again until it's at 20%. And then you have this whole dead zone where the fan's not actually doing anything. But if you properly tune this off below value, then essentially anytime the fan is called for at 5%, which it shouldn't because you know that your fan can't run below 10%. But if for some reason it tries to run at 5%, the next time it goes above 10% and it says, I want to run at 10%, it will reinitialize this kickstart time. So it knows, oh, I'm at 10%. I was below 10% before. My fan needs an extra kick to get started. So see what you see what you find out there with your fan. You may be able to run it at lower speeds than expected. But there's so many different fans from China, across Amazon, across the world. You know, we're a lot of the times using some kind of crappy fans, and so you may need to adjust these settings. But I'm not going to go over the controller fans or the case light output. Let's see here. I'll try to speed up here because I know this is maybe boring for some people. Homing override. There is Safe Z homing, which works as well. I still have homing override here, which is nice because after it homes, it goes to the center. So if you need to do a preheat routine, you can home your printer and then do that. Quad gantry level. Again, we have a 350. So we're going to define the gantry corners and probe points. So these are the belt locations relative to your X0 and Y0 settings. So this is saying that my front left belt is 60 millimeters to the right of my build plate and 10 millimeters to the front of my build plate. And then same thing with the back right one. So that defines all four gantry corner locations. If those values aren't perfect, if they're within a few millimeters or even like 10 millimeters, it's probably fine. It'll just take a little longer for your printer to converge when it's running quad gantry level, which, you know, if you tweak it perfectly, you might save, you know, 10 seconds, but it's not a big deal. Probe points. This is one of the places where the probe offset has not been applied. So if you remember, in the probe section, we had a Y offset of 25 millimeters. So here we need to essentially apply the probe offset to these points so that the nozzle, so that the probe is at the position we're actually targeting. So in this case, we want 50-50, 50-300, 300, 300, and 350. So we essentially subtracted 25 millimeters from all of the nozzle positions. So the probe is at the 50-50, etc. But maybe eventually that'll get updated so that it uses essentially probe points instead of nozzle points. That'll be convenient. But that's what it is. So, and if you get creative and you've proven your printer can go fast, you could do this to like 200 or 300 millimeters. It looks cool too. This retry tolerance, again, some people may disagree with this, but I typically make my retry tolerances quite small. From a print standpoint, this really doesn't matter if it's, you know, a little bit bigger than this, but from a initially getting set up standpoint, I want quad gantry level to air out if someone is trying to quad gantry level during a time when the probe is shifting. So if it's not within, if it's within these, this, you know, less than 0.0075 millimeters, that means I think everything's stable. If it's greater than that and it can never converge and it retries five times, it can never do it. Either one, something mechanical is messed up. Maybe you have a loose grub screw, maybe your belts are loose, something like that. Or on the other hand, you know, maybe your probe's drifting, maybe something's loose. So I'd rather check that now and get someone annoyed saying, my printer never quad gantry levels, so we can help people get set up and get their printer tuned properly at the beginning, than fighting first layer problems for months down the road and trying to just banging your head against the wall trying to figure it out. Let's see here. Okay. Then for displays, I will be upgrading to the Mini 12864. He has that available, but right now he has this standard RepWrap display. So I'm going to do this. And depending on your display, this output pin beeper, sometimes you won't really care about it, but depending on the display, essentially it can be floating if you don't define it. So it's not fully on beeping, but it's not fully off, which even if it's like 50% beeping, it's still really freaking loud and it will annoy the crap out of you. So you need to define it so that it's either low or high so that essentially the beeper doesn't beep unless it needs to. I just want to touch on this display section one more a little bit for the Mini 12864 because I have gotten some questions about how to set colors properly. So one, remember that you need to rotate the connector housings on the display 180 degrees. You can check Uber's video from last night on how to do that, but it's really easy. You just take a screwdriver and pry it up. The little black piece essentially is loose. You can pull it off, rotate it 180 degrees, and press it back on. The other thing, and actually I'm not going to uncomment that because then it won't work, but you need to uncomment this NeoPixel section. As long as you have a V2.1 version of the display. The previous ones had RGB, but they were analog, so it had three pins that were just essentially 0 to 100%. Most of the ones you'll find on AliExpress are the V2.1 style that uses NeoPixels, so you can address them like this. If you don't uncomment the section, though, the backlight won't come on, and then you'll wonder why your display isn't working, but it's actually just the display is working, there's just no backlight. And then this section, so essentially what this does, this lets you define red, green, and blue, which is great, but a lot of times you may want the display section with text to be one color and then the knob to be a different color, or maybe the knob to be two different colors. And so that's why we have this delayed G-code section. So after it, after the printer starts up and Clipper starts, it'll run these three commands to essentially set the three NeoPixels that are in that display to unique values. So in this case, index one is the display. So in this case, they're all one, so this would be a white display. And then index two and three are the left and right LEDs on the knob. And so in this case, they're both set to red. So this would be a red knob and a white display as default. If your color, if you know you use this exact G code and your colors are messed up, then take a look at the color order GRB as false. It may need to be true. Sometimes the order of the RGB values are different, so you can mess around with that if your colors aren't matching up. Wow, I wasn't planning on going through that much in the printer config, but hopefully that was a good overview into printer configs. I will touch on one more thing, or two more things. Anytime you run a probe-related check, so if you're running a quad gantry level or a Z tilt for V1, quad gantry level for V2, you always need to home Z afterwards, because Clipper doesn't understand that you're using the probe as a relative reference and the Z end stop pin as the absolute reference. So it'll just take whatever Z was last used and use that as your official Z moving forward. So if you home your printer XYZ with the pin, and then you run a quad gantry level, and then you start a print, your print will be using the probe offset instead of the end stop pin offset. And those may be completely different depending on your printer. You could easily just crash the nozzle into your brand new PEI and have a gouge cut into it, or worse. Or you could even bend the X-axis because you crash the toolhead. You don't want to do that. So anytime you start a print, anything like that, you want to make sure you have a G28 in there. And so how I have it, I have a print start command, and I just, in my slicer, I'll just dump print start and print end into it. So if I switch between Cura, Prusa slicer, or whatever, I can just put these two values in there, and then all of my custom settings are the same across all the slicers. This print start has almost nothing in it, which can be good and can be bad. It's good because nothing bad happens. It's bad because maybe it's not as convenient as you would like. If we jump over to the Voron repos, I may have mistakenly or on purpose or by accident added my start routine. Let's see here. To print start. Yes, so I did. So you may be able to use this. The one thing I like about my print start is that, so I home XYZ, in this case it's a V1, so I do Z tilde adjust. Also, because I'm lazy and because I haven't perfectly adjusted my printer, I do use a bed mesh calibrate 3x3 matrix. And then essentially what I do is I go to the 5/5 location, so the front right corner of the bed. And this section right here essentially extrudes filament for 120-ish millimeters. It goes across the bed to the right and then zigzags or goes back to the left before essentially raising the tool head and moving it to the center of the bed. So I found that essentially this covers me in almost all cases. If there's something on the nozzle that would essentially get in the way of a print, this purge line will essentially clear it off. The goo on the nozzle gets kind of caught in the purge line. So that may be useful. It may not, but if you feel like using it, it's there. Also, if you're on a V2 and you positively know you need bed mesh, grab it from the V1 config. So you can do that. But okay, I'm going to hit save. And then I have just saved that. Let's see here. 9.32. So this is the latest version. I'm going to drop it in. Overwrite. And let's go back to Octoprint and do a firmware restart. Let's see what... It did ready and then it shut down. Let's see what the status... okay. ADC out of range. So this is the error I was expecting before. Again, this means that the thermistor is not plugged in, which means I think the hot end thermistor is actually plugged into the X, which is great. So let's go ahead and quickly jump over to the, if I can find what window I'm in, let's jump over to the printer and hook that up. I think we can get that plugged in and get that error fixed.
Okay. So here's the thermistor. And it is kind of floating around here. So I will go ahead and let's see here. The bed one should be this bottom one. One thing to note, this is a DuPont connector, which is not great for plugging into a JST. These plugs are a JST on the board. They do work temporarily, but I would encourage you to swap them out for JST wherever you can, because over time it's not a secure connection. So if your printer is vibrating, which it will, it could work itself loose and then cause a print to fail or something to short out or something like that, and you don't want that to happen. Especially with stepper motors, it can easily damage the stepper driver if you unplug the stepper motor while something's happening. And this would essentially be that. So not a good idea. And yes, it is live right now. So I'll be careful here. Okay, so that's plugged in. Again, it's not very secure, so I would prefer to have a JST connection on it, but I'll get that fixed later on.
Okay, so we're back. Let's go to firmware. Oops. Firmware restart again. And it's ready. Let's see if it stays ready. It does. Okay, so we got. So we have temperatures for the bed and the tool head, which is fantastic. Let's see here. What else do I want to do? I think I'm getting to the point where we may wrap it up for today. If there's any questions or anything like that, feel free to post them in the comments. But I'll probably wrap up here in a second. Let me just pull up my guide just to double check to see if there's anything I'm missing. Let's see here. Repositories. So yeah, so here's where that setup guide is. Again, this is actually, this applies to this printer right now, which is great. But let's see here. So if you have any questions about wiring or anything like that in general, feel free to read through here. Again, these diagrams aren't updated for the latest of everything, but they're still, everything else is pretty much still applicable, including the wiring for the bat diode. So installing Clipper. Okay, the other thing to note is that it is not throwing any errors for unable to communicate with the stepper driver. So that's great. Let's see here. So if it says like TMC driver not available or it can't communicate via UART, essentially that means often either your stepper driver is bad, which is probably not the case, but you really want to check to make sure your SKR boards are actually powered via 24 volts or 12 volts, because if you're just powering your SKR boards via USB or 5 volts, essentially the TMC drivers won't be on, and so Clipper won't be able to communicate with them, so you'll get that error. Let's see here. Let's see here. I would love to do a mainsail install. I actually did it. I went through the process recently and got it up and running and used it for a bit. But again, with all the accelerometer testing I've been doing recently, I haven't been able to do both of those at the same time. But I should be able to do that soon. Also, Raymond is actually working on kind of a single image that has everything needed, which would essentially be the same thing I did with Octoprint, which is just flashing an image to the SD card, adding your printer config and the your Wi-Fi information, and then just it all being ready to go, including your webcam streaming, which in the current mainsail install, you actually have to manually install MMJPEG, which I had never done before, and it's, again, it's just copying someone else's guides, but it's still a pain. From Octoprint pauses 30 seconds after I type a command or hit home before it actually does it. That's a great question. I don't know what would be causing that. I would check, let's see here. I would check to make sure you flashed your SKRs with the latest firmware if you've updated Clipper. If you haven't updated Clipper, it shouldn't have changed anything. But potentially there may be a... let me think about this. I want to say there was one plugin recently that was... there was like this one version that essentially locked up Octoprint or caused it to respond really slowly. I'm not sure if it was Bed Visualizer or something else like that, but... just make sure your plugins are up to date and try disabling plugins that you're not using right now to see, or even ones you are using, disable them one by one and see if that helps speed things up. But let's see here. And yeah, so this, the annoying thing here is that it, yeah, you're right. This does point to the old config. There was a while there where pull requests were kind of lagging on Voron users, so I haven't gotten around to updating that. However, if you are curious, if you go to my GitHub, if we go to the documentation, you'll notice here in setup guide, I'm actually trying to kind of rework the this SKR PDF into Markdown. So again, this is really not complete at all, but we're trying to kind of get it together so that, I guess that link's broken. It's really not ready for prime time, but we're trying to make it more modular and keep it updated. So hopefully eventually we'll have a Voron documentation repo essentially that will have things like this easily accessible and updatable. So if there's an issue you see, if someone made a typo or a link's outdated, you can update it. And create a pull request, we can get that updated. So the magnetic bed interfere with the probe. So as long as you have a, I used a PEI sheet and just directly on the aluminum initially, and that works great as long as your probe has a sense distance of around 8 millimeters. You can't use the Omron probe or the PL8 or PL05 probe, which is a 5 millimeter probe, because it doesn't have a long enough sense distance on aluminum. You'll end up hitting your nozzle. But the let's see here. If you install a magnetic bed, like a sheet, and then put a spring steel sheet on top of that, you'll be fine. The one thing to note, though, is if you just have the magnetic bed on without the spring steel, and then you try to probe with one of those short distance probes, essentially the probe won't detect and in time, and you'll essentially crash the nozzle into the bed, which you don't want to do. So try to keep your spring steel sheet on there all the time, just in case you by accidentally do that. But the beds with embedded magnets in certain locations, especially the really powerful magnets, those do interfere with the probe. So we really haven't taken that into account at all for quad gantry level or anything like that, because those magnet locations aren't really standard. But you will definitely need to work around that. And I haven't used one of those beds yet or before. Let's see here. Spring steel is, I've ended up switching to Altastick for my, essentially my main printers. Unfortunately, they don't have a 350 by 350 yet. And it is expensive. Essentially the quality and the durability is really fantastic. The energetic spring steel sheets, you really have to be careful with, because the PEI is so thin that if you crash your nozzle once, essentially that section of the PEI is not usable anymore. So I have quite a few energetic sheets at my house here that are essentially, I've gouged a section of them, and I don't use them anymore, except for certain things, certain specific materials, for some reason work better on PEI, if you really have something that likes to warp. But the Altastick, the surface is so hard, that even if I've crashed the nozzle, like not a major crash, but a minor crash before. And it doesn't seem to really gouge the surface. It's kind of like a hardened like coating, on top that seems to survive, and it does auto release as well. So I've just gone ahead and bought that for my printers. It is double-sided, and it does last a long time. I've heard of some people that say, essentially they'll use both sides and it'll last 6 months of heavy use or something. I don't know. I've had mine since, it's been a while, maybe 9 months. And again, on my 250, it's actually a 250 by maybe 235 or 240 size. So it doesn't cover the entire surface, but it works. I did get their magnet for this next round on my V2.4, not the one back here, but the one in the room back beyond. I have the Live XY or Magic Studios V2.4 kit that I'm going to be putting together here in the next few weeks after I get this printer done. So I'll be able to test out Altastick's magnet. The energetic magnet's bad, I've heard. The Triangle Labs magnet, though, that I have, I think they have a 300 by 300 and a maybe a 250 by, or maybe a Prusa size. But I've actually beat that magnet up a lot and, you know, tried it at a lot of different temperatures, and it's still holding strong. So I recommend their, at least as of like a year and a half ago, their magnet was good. That's always the tricky part. But again, for like $5 or $10 or whatever it was, if you're already making an order from them, you might as well pick up a sheet. So, but let's see here. And the one thing on the progress plugin on the display, I haven't gotten that updated yet. I know there's a plugin to get that working, the display layer progress. It's just not used at all on my my printers. I know with the latest Clipper menu update, there was some changes. I was using the chamber temperature guide that someone did that allowed you to display the chamber temperature on the display. That was really nice, but the latest update has broken that. So I'm not exactly sure why the display was menu structure was changed, or what is the difference. But if you guys have any information, let me know. The one thing I would like to eventually get a Voron menu structure, essentially, because there's a lot of things in there that we don't use. And there's certain things that would be nice to have, like a quad gantry level or Z-tilt or probe accurate. There's a lot of different functions that I use on a daily basis that would be convenient to have. And I'm not sure if they fixed the menu, the move menu, where it limits you to a maximum of 200 by 200 unless you change the setting in the in your config file. But that would be nice to have fixed as well. But let's see. Any other comments? Yep. But I think that's it for now. Let's see here. So we're basically to the point where it's starting, and so let's see here. So we're basically to this configuration check standpoint. This printer, he updated it, but the mounts for the gantry to the Z rails are actually missing. So I printed some of those, but I haven't installed them yet. So before we actually start moving the tool head around and checking all the stepper motors, we have to get that assembly done, because it would be really funny to run the accelerometer test when the gantry can float around like a half an inch in each direction. So, yep. So, and that's it. So yeah, the next live stream we'll go through the configuration checks. Once we get it moving, I will go ahead and swap the branch over to the one for the sensor. And we'll go from there. But I hope you guys enjoyed. We'll go from there. Yeah, there was a lot of information here that you can probably skim over a lot faster. I may do a shorter guide, kind of like I did the initial setup. But unfortunately, the ones with a lot of shortcuts like that take a lot of time. And trying to maximize my time there. So you're great. Well, that's it for today. So, have a good one, guys, or ladies and gentlemen, I'll say. So.